Wow, what a year it's been for astronomy. With a number of groundbreaking discoveries and amazing missions taking place, to seeing things we've never seen before. It's been a wild ride for the space community. So join me as we revisit the past year's highlights and explore the biggest space discoveries from each month of the year. Let's go. This year started off with a bang, literally. In January, astronomers made a historic discovery when they saw a star explode in real time for the first time ever. Now, I know what you're gonna say.
Well, technically it's not real time because a star's millions of light years away, so we can never see it in real time. And you're absolutely right. We cannot see this explosion in absolute real time because it's really far away. But what I mean here is that astronomers saw it transition into a supernova. Before, generally, we'd only seen the aftermath of a star's dramatic death, not the immediate before, during, and after. But that makes more sense. Carry on.
The star, now known as Supernova SN 2020 TLF, was a red supergiant star with a mass around 10 to 12 times the mass of our Sun, sitting at around 115 million light years away in this galaxy, NGC 5731. Red supergiant stars are the largest type of stars in the universe in terms of volume. They usually have a mass of around 8 to 30 times the mass of the Sun and are destined to explode in a dramatic supernova. Two classic examples of red supergiant stars that you may have seen with your own eyes in the night sky is the heart of the Scorpion, Antares, and Orion's red shoulder, Betelgeuse. Astronomers were alerted to this particular red supergiant star when it began emitting bright radiation. They observed it for 130 days until it exploded, and then for a further 300 days afterwards. While we do know a lot about stars and the lives they lead, not a great deal is known about the processes at work in the very final moments of a star's life. And that's why astronomers kept observing the supernova 300 days after the explosion to get as much data as possible to understand these processes even better. This was a major breakthrough and gave us valuable insight into those final moments of a star's life. It could also help us in the future to spot potential supernovae moments before they happen, so we can continue to study these processes that govern the death of stars. February wasn't any less colossal when astronomers found the biggest galactic structure to date. This is Alcyoneus, a massive radio galaxy that spans a whopping 16.3 million light years across. That's equivalent to 160 Milky Ways. The structures that make this galaxy so big are called radio lobes, which many galaxies have, even the Milky Way has some. They're a pair of roughly symmetrical structures on either side of a galaxy with a particularly active supermassive black hole at its center, and they emit mostly radio light. The size and extent of radio lobes depend on a number of factors, but astronomers aren't quite certain why these particular lobes are so huge, especially since they come from a galaxy that's pretty ordinary, and it has a pretty ordinary supermassive black hole in its center as well. It could be that, potentially, Alcyoneus sits in a region of space with very low density, and so there's less friction allowing for those lobes to extend out further. Whatever the reason, it's the biggest structure of galactic origin ever found in the universe, and astronomers believe that it's still growing larger. Now grab a cup of tea, because there was drama in March this year, with a rogue rocket booster set to crash into the far side of the moon. Now, having a rocket booster accidentally crash into the moon is certainly dramatic, but the real drama was about who this rocket belongs to. The rocket booster was first spotted in 2015, but it was initially thought to be an asteroid. But then, astronomer Bill Gray identified it as a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket stage that launched NASA's Deep Space Climate Observatory into orbit in early 2015. When the news had spread, John Giorgini from NASA's JPL reached out to Bill saying that his math didn't check out and it couldn't be the Falcon 9 rocket stage. So, who did it belong to? Bill went back to the drawing board and later identified the rogue rocket booster as China's rocket that launched the Chang'e 5T1 mission to the moon in late 2014. But China denied this also. The drama. Whoever it belonged to, it crashed into the moon on the 4th of March and left behind quite a crater. A double crater. It's uncertain why the crash resulted in a double crater, but this may indicate that the rocket booster was heavy at both ends, which is not very typical for a rocket, because usually they're just heavy at one end, the engine end. And that could help us identify who it belonged to. Enough space tea, let's move on. Much like February, in April we also confirmed a biggest thing, but this one was the biggest comet ever discovered, Comet Bernardinelli-Bernstein. Most comets tend to be only a couple of kilometers wide. One of the most famous comets, Halley's Comet, is only around 10 kilometers wide. But this monster is a whopping 140 kilometers wide. Comet Bernardinelli-Bernstein was discovered by two astronomers, Pedro Bernardinelli and Gary Bernstein, who used an algorithm to help track slow-moving objects like comets in archived data of the Dark Energy Survey. It was spotted in images taken between October 2014 and November 2018, but officially announced in June 2021. But what's really cool is that after the announcement, numerous pre-coveries were made. That is, finding images of the object that predate its official discovery date. One of the earliest pre-coveries was taken by a telescope on the 15th of November in 2010 from the Paranal Observatory in Chile. The comet will reach its closest approach to the Sun in 2031, getting about as close as the orbit of Saturn, before making its way back out to the far reaches of the solar system, where it won't return for another 3 million years. Now, May was a very special month for the astronomy community because the world got its first look at a direct image of the supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy, Sagittarius A star. Previously, we've been able to detect it indirectly by watching stars whiz around it due to its gravitational pull of 4 million suns, but we never had a direct image of it before May. This photo was taken by the Event Horizon Telescope, which isn't just one telescope. It's a collection of multiple telescopes around the world that link together to essentially create a single telescope the size of our planet. This photo isn't the first that we've seen from the Event Horizon Telescope, nor is it the first direct image of a black hole that we've seen either. The first time we saw a direct image of a black hole was when the Event Horizon collaboration released its first image in April 2019. That was of the black hole at the center of the galaxy M87, some 53 million light years away, with a whopping mass of 6.5 billion times the mass of the Sun. Fun fact, trying to find that black hole was like trying to spot a tennis ball on the moon. I'm pointing to my moon. I painted that. In June, something very cool happened for us down under. NASA had its very first launch from a commercial launch facility located outside the US, and that was from right here in Australia. It was also NASA's first launch from Australia in 27 years. The mission, which focuses on measuring interstellar X-rays, was launched from Equatorial Launch Australia's Arnhem Space Centre, located on the Dumpuma Plateau near Nhulunbuy on the lands of the Yolngu people in the Northern Territory. For those who may not know, the Yolngu people are the local Aboriginal people of the area, who even helped build the facility on their lands. This particular launch that happened in late June was one of three. This first one carried an X-ray quantum calorimeter, which allows astronomers from the University of Michigan to measure interstellar X-rays to study the structure and evolution of the universe. The following two missions, launched in early July, focused on our nearest stellar neighbors, the Alpha Centauri binary pair, Alpha Centauri A and Alpha Centauri B. But July had something much more special for the space community to celebrate, and that was the first images released from what I would argue to be the most anticipated space mission of 2022, heck, maybe even the century, the JWST. JWST is the largest space telescope to date, and it unfolded the universe to us time and time again since the first images were released on the 12th of July this year. We got a sneak peek of the first official image from the JWST, known as Webb's first deep field, unveiled by US President Joe Biden on the 11th of July. JWST gazed at the galaxy cluster SMAX 0723, the pale yellow blobs around the center of the image, for a total time of 12.5 hours, revealing some of the faintest galaxies from the distant, distant universe. Everything you see in this image, every blob, smudge, and dot, everything without these distinctive JWST diffraction spikes, which come from the hexagonal shape of the mirrors, everything else is a galaxy. Feel small yet? Just wait, it gets worse. The size of this piece of sky with thousands of galaxies in it is equivalent to the size of a grain of sand held at arm's length. So everywhere you look in the sky, every single grain of sand piece of sky has thousands upon thousands of galaxies hiding in it, waiting for JWST to spot them for us. All right, let's just put a pin in that existential crisis for now and move on to the other photos. First up is this. And honestly, it's unreal. This is an image of NGC 3324, a region of the Carina Nebula, 7,500 light years away, that's forming stars. This image was dubbed the Cosmic Cliffs, and for good reason, resembling cliff-faced mountains with the tallest peaks like this thumb-looking figure measuring 7 light years in height. We also got a new look at a group of galaxies known as Stefan's Quintet in the largest of JWST's first release of images, containing over 150 million pixels, covering a section of the sky around 1/5 the diameter of the moon. This image reveals details never seen before, like this massive shockwave from one of the galaxies smashing through the cluster.
The final cosmic image was of the Southern Ring Nebula, a planetary nebula left over from the slow death of a star like our Sun. And as you can see, we were graced with two different views of this object. The left shows what JWST sees in near-infrared light, light that's just beyond the red end of the spectrum, and on the right we see what JWST reveals in mid-infrared light. Dual views like this are what makes JWST so incredible, revealing different views, giving us a broader understanding of the science taking place in these distant laboratories. Honestly, I could talk about JWST all day, but then this video will end up like H-Bomber Guy's video about the Roblox oof sound, and no one wants that, so let's just move on to August.
But before we get to August, we need to go further back in time to summer of 2019-2020, Australian summer that is, where a stellar favourite did something quite dramatic. Old red supergiant Betelgeuse mysteriously dimmed, getting as low as 35% of its usual brightness in February 2020. Now, it isn't uncommon for Betelgeuse to get a little dim sometimes. It actually does this quite periodically, and this variation in the brightness of Betelgeuse was recorded and noted by the Kokatha people of the Great Victorian Desert. They saw the stars of Orion also as a hunter, but knew it by the name of Nyiruna, who was in love with the Yugarilia, also known as the Pleiades. But they shy away from his advances and are protected by the older sister, Kumbuguda. In the oral tradition of the Kokatha people, Nyiruna generates fire magic in his right hand, represented by the star Betelgeuse getting brighter. But Kumbuguda counters with her own fire magic, represented by the star Aldebaran, and Nyiruna's fire magic dissipates, with Betelgeuse getting fainter. But Nyiruna is persistent and generates his fire magic again to go after the sisters once more, which are represented again by Betelgeuse getting brighter. Now, this clearly shows that the Kokatha people were keen astronomers who noted down the varying brightness of Betelgeuse, which happens over about 400 days, all without telescopes. But in summer of 2019-2020, it did get unusually dim. And now, in August of 2022, we may have actually found a reason why this happened. Betelgeuse exploded. Just a little. Not quite full-on supernova explosion, we're still waiting for that to happen, but more like coronal mass ejection level explosion. Similar to what we see with our Sun, but 400 million times more powerful. The gas from that stellar fart likely blocked some of the light from Betelgeuse shining in our direction, making it appear dim. Unfortunately, this doesn't mean it's closer to a supernova level explosion, but I have my fingers crossed that it will happen sometime in our lifetime. September was also quite an exciting time for us space nerds, with the success of NASA's Double Asteroid Redirection Test, or DART mission, where we saw the intentional crashing of a spacecraft into an asteroid. It was the first ever test of planetary defense, and it worked! Astonishingly well, too! NASA targeted the small asteroid Dimorphos that orbits around the larger asteroid Didymos to test the kinetic impactor method of planetary defense, where basically you smash something into an asteroid in the hopes that the momentum and kinetic energy transfer of that collision moves the asteroid off its course. They expected the impact to change the orbit of Dimorphos such that it would shorten the time it takes to orbit Didymos by approximately 10 minutes. But the impact worked so well they managed to shorten its orbit by 32 minutes. I know that can sound concerning, and it sounds like NASA was off by a factor of 3, which could be disastrous if there was an asteroid on a collision course with Earth, but not to worry. This is why we test these things. The composition of Dimorphos wasn't completely known, and that greatly impacts the effectiveness of the collision. So much so that the debris that was kicked up by the crash enhanced the push it gave to the asteroid. This allowed us to improve our model so that we can be more precise in the future when it really matters, so we don't end up like these guys. Shortly after the success of the DART mission, on the 9th of October, astronomers saw what could be the most powerful cosmic explosion ever detected. It was a gamma ray burst, dubbed GRB-221009, likely resulting from a star 30 times the mass of the Sun ending its life and transforming into a black hole. This particular gamma ray burst is at least 10 times as bright as the previous energetic gamma ray bursts, earning it the title of the BOAT, the brightest of all time. It was first spotted by gamma ray and X-ray telescopes, and minutes later an astronomer telegram, which I think we should rename to a stellagram, was sent out to the astronomical community, resulting in many other telescopes looking to watch the BOAT. By closely watching this event from the initial blast to when it eventually fades into the background of space, astronomers will be able to get an idea into the physics behind these energetic explosions and figure out how exactly black holes form. The blast could take months to fade enough for astronomers to get detailed looks at the BOAT to figure out more about the supernova and the galaxy it calls home. But astronomers will definitely be keeping an eye on this one, because energetic bursts like this could be where some of the heaviest elements in the universe are birthed. Now in November, another highly anticipated space mission finally launched, and that was the Artemis 1 mission to the moon. This was a huge step forward in NASA's plan to eventually land humans back on the moon in 2024. The Artemis 1 mission was an uncrewed test flight carrying the Orion spacecraft on a 3-week journey around the moon and back to Earth. This was the first time that NASA had sent a spacecraft on a journey of this length since the Apollo missions in the 1970s. And while there were no humans on board this particular flight, there were still some very valuable crew members, including some mannequins resembling male and female bodies to test various experiences of the flight, as well as a Snoopy plushie dressed in a spacesuit which acted as the official zero-G indicator. But this isn't the first time Snoopy's been involved in a mission to the moon. The Apollo 10 capsule was nicknamed Snoopy because it was snooping around for a landing site for the iconic follow-up mission, Apollo 11. Artemis 1 and astronaut Snoopy successfully launched from the same launch pad as the Apollo 10 mission on the 16th of November, and successfully completed its 3-week journey around the moon and fell back to Earth with splashdown on the 11th of December. This is just the beginning for the Artemis mission, which aims to establish a sustained human presence on the moon, which will springboard us to exploring places like Mars. I am so excited to see what the future holds. And finally, that brings us to December, where, as of filming this, the biggest space discovery of the last month of the year was from none other than the JWST, where it was confirmed that it had found the most distant galaxy ever seen. Now, early in the year, it was teased that JWST may have found the most distant galaxy ever seen, but we couldn't confirm it then, because in order to determine the distance to a distant galaxy, you need rainbows, or what we like to call in astronomy, spectra. By breaking up a galaxy's light into a rainbow, we're able to see certain features and where they fall in that spectrum. And the location of certain features can tell us a lot about the distance that these galaxies are from us. A particular feature in the spectrum of young distant galaxies is called the Lyman break, where the spectrum is bright at wavelengths longer than 912 angstroms, but there's a clear drop at shorter wavelengths because lots of that light gets absorbed by gas in regions of galaxies that are forming stars. Now, because of the expansion of the universe, the light from these distant galaxies gets redshifted, and the Lyman break doesn't appear at 912 angstroms, but at much longer wavelengths, like those that JWST studies. And by comparing where this feature falls in the spectra of these galaxies to where it's supposed to be without the redshifting, we can accurately determine their distance. The most distant galaxy that JWST has found so far has been confirmed to be at a redshift of 13.2, which corresponds to 13.5 billion light years away. But there are other galaxies that are candidates for the most distant galaxy, but they're yet to be confirmed. So I'm sure it won't be long before JWST breaks its own record. What a year it's been. Thank you for joining me on this journey. I hope you've enjoyed learning about these big space discoveries and have a newfound appreciation for the vastness and complexity of our universe. Space exploration is a constantly evolving field. There's always new things to discover and learn about our universe. And I can't wait to see what the future holds as we continue to push those boundaries of what we know in 2023. Thank you again for watching. I hope you'll join me for more space-related content in the future. But until then, clear skies and happy stargazing. Oh, and Happy New Year, space nerds!